When Prince Dapo Abiodun assumed office as governor of Ogun State in May 2019, he declared a state of emergency in the education sector, having seen the deplorable state of the educational system.
The state of education in the state is worrisome. We have been regaled with stories of unpaid salaries, poor funding, unlimited deductions, moribund projects, controversial campus relocations, hasty appointments, strikes, etc. Confidence has been eroded. Unless we act quickly, education which is already in serious trouble will get worse. We cannot afford to have our education, which should be the bedrock of all our development activities, our topmost industry, be in such a state. Today, this state has the largest number of public and private universities, and we are indeed the Boston of the United States of America. Restoring the glory of the state education system requires an urgent, comprehensive, and disruptive approach akin to the declaration of a state of emergency.
This led to the introduction of a vibrant and deliberate approach to ensuring that the state returns to its path of glory in the sector. To achieve this, the governor embarked on a series of deliberate and determined actions with a view to ensuring a reversal of the ugly trend, which had the potential of sliding our dear state into educational oblivion. In the first place, Prince Abiodun set up the machinery to bring radical improvement to the infrastructure in schools, owing to the sorry state of affairs of the classrooms and other structures that existed in primary and post-primary schools all around the state, which had spanned for many years. And in a space of a short while, no fewer than 965 schools spread across the four divisions of the state, namely Remo, Ijebu, Yewa, and Egba, had been built or rehabilitated. This is referred to as the Yellow Roof Revolution, a feat which is visible to all and sundry in the nooks and crannies of the state. These are only a few among schools which felt the impact of the intervention of the present administration.
This is my sixth year in the school, and before I came home, this building, this 12-story building, 10-block building, is linking from top to down. It's not habitable, so we cannot put our pupils there. Then with the help of our government, by the time our governor came into power, this building was renovated for us. And also, we have borehole in the school. And also, the school fence was reconstructed. It had experience when they have fence, because our school compound is the community toilet. We are hiding the money, the dorm, their feces in the school compound. So at the entrance of the school, all kinds of people came in. But with the insertion of our governor, the fence was reconstructed, and we no longer experience any offenses in the school. So also we enjoy the school borehole. Came into being, and the classroom now is very, very conducive for learners.
We need to appreciate the His Excellency, our executive governor, Dapo Abiodun. We really appreciate him for being putting the best. That is, you can see this is 2 blocks of classroom, and this is another 4 blocks of classroom. It has been renovated, and when you get to this classroom, you see how the pupils are sitting comfortably. So we really appreciate government for that.
His Excellency Prince Dapo Abiodun renovated a block of 4 classrooms for us in the GSS section. and the building has been so useful to us. It accommodated about 180 learners, and the students have been making use of it. It's very conducive. It's a very conducive environment. Even they donated furniture items for the block. So the students have been enjoying it, and the teachers, we are very, very grateful for the good job well done by His Excellency. We thank him and wish him good success.
Thank Governor Dankwa-Abiodun for giving us the yellow roof. It has really helped the school because we have been able to place all the students in the various classes, and it has helped them to move freely in the class. They are not so jam-packed again. It has really helped us. And the school students, they like it because the building is very fine, you know. Fine structure, it has enhanced the beauty of the school. So I want to say thank you to the governor, and we want more of it, more grace to help him.
Shortly after the government assumed duty, it restored the appointment of principals general and head teachers general. This came a long way in restoring the confidence and sense of belonging of teachers as important players in the development process of society. Only recently, the state governor, Prince Dankwa-Abiodun, presented these top officials with official vehicles for further effectiveness in the discharge of their duties.
When it was restored, we felt that we should restore it with all the necessary paraphernalia, with all the dignity that it deserves. We don't want to just have principals general without something that perquisites of office that goes along with it. And that was what led to His Excellency giving them, each of them, brand new cars. Also the head teachers general at the level of primary school. So today you can see that sense of fulfillment and that joy, and every teacher, even ordinary teacher, seeing that the office of principals general and head teachers general represents something, is symbolic, and it gives them that fulfillment that they are recognized by government, and at least this office gives us a sort of connection, and that means that we are not forgotten in the scheme of things.
One of the interventions which the present administration embarked upon came as a result of government's recognition of shortage of staff in many of the schools, especially in the rural areas. To this end, Prince Abiodun conceived of an idea known as Ogun Teach, which saw government employing thousands of teachers to fill identified vacancies, thereby providing the needed personnel to impart knowledge in students.
We brought in what we call the Ogun Teach, that is Ogun Teaching Experience Acquisition Channel. So through that innovative introduction, we're able to now reduce the pressure on teachers. I can tell you this one for free. In the last 10 to 12 years, teachers have not been employed in Ogun State. So this governor came and started now reducing this problem in schools. So we actually interviewed about 12,000. Those who applied originally were over 25,000. But we shortlisted about 12,000, out of which we eventually took 5,000. So those 5,000 are to be injected into the schools. We have done 2,000. The next 1,000 is in the pipeline for us to send to schools again. Because we are not just employing teachers for the sake of it. Because if you employ 5,000 teachers and you just send them to schools, you'll be surprised that you might be putting teachers in places where you don't need to put teachers. So what we are doing is, from our platform, we know where there are deficits, and then we are putting teachers in those schools. So through the Teach program, we have been able to put in more teachers in the classroom.
Meanwhile, technology has been identified as a major factor if the dream of the revitalization of the education sector must be realized. The present administration is fully conscious of this, as can be seen in its various efforts at entrenching information technology into the livelihood of the citizenry through its IT interventions. The Ogun State Ministry of Education, Science and Technology initiated the introduction and adoption of technology to encourage digital culture and integration. The umbrella structure under which these components reside is known as the Ogun State Education Revitalization Agenda, OGCERA.
That platform is what we use to manage data. So as I sit here, I can tell you how many learners we have in each of the local governments in the state through the it's generally called the Oxera platform, where it's actually a digital platform for education revitalization. So if you go around now, everybody is talking about Oxera. It has helped us to know how many schools we have, how many classes we have, how many learners we have, how many of them are males, how many of them are females.
Within this innovation is the learner's identification number. This exists for easy identification of public and private learners in order to have proper data. It will also curb examination malpractices.
Every learner in our state today has what we call learner identification number. The learner identification number is unique, and through that number, you know everybody in our school. So if you use names, it is possible for 2-3 people to bear the same names, and that will not let you have any uniqueness in that. So with the LIN now, the learner identification number, we are able to identify each learner, and that has also gone ahead to help us in the area of examination malpractice. So to also help to ensure that facilities that we take to schools, we know how to distribute all these things to schools, and performance of learners are also measured.
Another component of OGCERA is the e-dossier for easy access to learners' report sheet by parents and guidance alike.
Now we are able to give result sheets to learners without having to print. So they just go online and get their report. So if a parent has any word in Abeokuta, and that parent happens to be in America, he doesn't need to come to Nigeria to even check the result of the learner. So he will just take the LIN and go to the platform, usually they call it the OCR platform, put it in, and then we'll be able to see the result. So knows the performance. That has made life very, very simple for us. So analytics, and once you have data, you can plan.
And poised to ensure better welfare and promote equality for children living with disabilities, to allow them display their intellectual abilities for a better life, the Ogun State Government, under the leadership of Prince Dapo Abiodun, continues to provide equipment that will enable easy learning and mobility for these youngsters. For example, government has ensured the rehabilitation of the 5 schools for children with special needs and has also distributed wheelchairs and white canes, in addition to resuscitating the Braille Book Production Center. It is instructive to observe that the Braille Book Production Center had been moribund for years.
The Braille Book Production Center, we came into the side and we found out that sometimes in 2007, there was a Braille Book Production Center. And shortly after that, maybe 1 or 2 years, something happened and it was not functioning again. So until this admission came and this governor gave approval for us to reawaken that center. So we started from the scratch, placed all the machines they are putting, the computers, and all the necessary equipment for us. Today, Ogun State Ministry of Education produces Braille materials for learners with visual impairment. Examination question papers for them, all the materials that they read for leisure and so on, we produce this from here. I mean, you can imagine what has happened for how many years before we now did that in 2020 that we brought back. And that has made life more very, very comfortable for learners in our special needs schools. You go downstairs, you see the Braille Book Production Center, and you see the equipment that we have there. And you know, that would take me to the library too. Many people, you know, you just talk about library and then just word of mouth and so on. When this admission came on board, we see the position, the situation of all our libraries. And we felt that no. If you say people are not patronizing library, it's because probably the library is not even performing the function that it should perform. Right from the outside, it should even be invited. So you need to see, look at the Simadipo Library. And we did something. In the Ministry of Education, Science and Technology here, we usually have library, which is like a modern library in the ministry. So that one, before, if you get to that library, you not even want to enter the library. But today, we have a library and media resource center. It also has study carriers where you can read. Even the governor can come there and read because it is done. It is so comfortable, and you can actually be in the study carriers and nobody even disturbs you. Apart from the fact that we have shelves and books are well laid out in that place. That is like a model for others. And if you now go to Simadi Local Library, you go to ASK, that is Kuku Library in Igebodi, and then the one at Ilaro. So you see what we have done in the area of library, improving the facilities.
The administration set up exam processing and reprographic center.
The examination reprographic center came about as a result of something that we noticed. When I came on board, I discussed with Excellency and we look at how we make our examination administration better than it was. And we look at what we've been doing, the paper, pen and paper things we have been doing. But we said some of these things we can actually even go to CBT. But we consider the fact that we should realize the various communities, particularly the rural areas, where there are no electricity and so on. So we may not be able to go that full hog. Now, so what do we do? We started with optical mark recognition sheets. Yeah, that's for OMR sheets. And then we made those OMR sheets customized. In other words, we personalize it. If we produce OMR sheets now for examination, a learner that is in Mekwaf, in one of the schools in Mekwaf, the paper that will be sent to that school from here, we already have the name of the school and the name of the learner for that. So we personalize. So it's for over 2 million learners that will be in the school during that period. That would, so all the objective questions that they would do would produce their OMR sheets. But we then have found that after the first year, I said OMR sheets are very, very sensitive. We now went to a step further, and we have a special type of OMR sheet that we use, which is actually more of an image recognition. That one, when learners handle it in the manner that is not very neat, it will see the scanner will still scan it. The other one, with a little bit of mishandling, it will not scan, and that can lead to failure for learners. So immediately we use it in one examination, the following examination we change it to this one that we're using. And we now said, okay, we don't have to be distributing objective for something to teachers to start marking and so on, and people will fall asleep when they are doing. So we purchased scanners. His Excellency gave us approval and purchased scanners. As we speak now, our scanners in that place, we show in the exam processing unit and reprographic center, I'm sure we have over 12 scanners, we have 12 to 15 scanners now.
A major concern which the present administration has tried to address is the disturbing reality of out-of-school children. This the administration has done through a host of measures such as the annual enrollment drive campaign.
Do we really have out-of-school children? Yes. Every state has out-of-school children. There we have grown so much in the state that Governor His Excellency Dr. Abiodun and FR has done so much in the state to reduce this to various minimum. But as people continue to have children every year, definitely we'll still be having this phenomenon. But because of what His Excellency has done in the area of the annual enrollment drive that we have, that we also have the platform for registration of all learners in our school, and we have an identification number for all our learners in school, it is possible for us to have accurate statistics. And I'm happy that this is happening today. It has happened in other states, it's not just for the state. When people hear about it, don't think that maybe there's a problem. No, we are doing this because we don't want to be in that category that people would say, what is happening to the state? This is the education capital of Nigeria, where education started. The person that actually started free education came from the state, and we are number one.
Another main thrust in resolving this menace is the free education policy, which this administration vigorously pursues, which is hoped would ensure that no child would have any justification to stay out of classes. Also, government continues to ensure provision of learning materials, distributes school bags and books, collaborates with relevant stakeholders, among other essential activities. All these with a view of providing conducive teaching and learning environment for the future leaders of tomorrow.
Beyond the normal budgetary allocation to education, we feel that there should be more creative ways of funding education. And that has led us to start thinking about what we call the Adopt a School program, where individuals, organizations can adopt schools and actually also intervene and help the state. And apart from that, we are engaging alumni better, that is also just our station, engaging them better to get them involved in school management. Parents are there, we call it Parents Forum, we call it the Parents Club, that's what we call it, the Parents Club. So through the Parents Club, we are also able to involve parents in the running of schools and participation in development of schools. And apart from that, there are some other avenues through which money can be sourced to fund education. That is what we want to launch. We call it the Education Trust Fund. Okay, the Education Trust Fund is another source that will be very, very useful in supporting education. Money from various sources like contracts, you know, some little maybe percentage and so on. So that will, and then also donation from individuals, organizations and so on. So we have all this together, and then through the Education Trust Fund, we can use that to support the normal budgetary allocation to education.
Another major component of the revitalization agenda has to do with curriculum development. And with regards to this, the state government approached it with a great degree of dynamism.
There is a national curriculum that every state or the federation that we use. It's not as if the state will have its own curriculum, but the ingenuity that we brought into it, making it more learner-centered, that one actually came in. It led to our response to the COVID challenge at that time. We were probably the first state to respond because there was lockdown, learners were at home. What are we going to do? We started what we call the Ogun class. The Ogun class came in, and our learners were engaged throughout that lockdown using the power of technology with telecommunication. And then we are coming up with what we call the digitalized lesson plans for teachers, so that whatever is taught in Abeokuta, that is what we find in Yebuye, what we find in Laro, in Shagama, and so many other things we are looking at in the area of the curriculum, and then using technology to drive that.
The present administration also dedicated a lot of attention to tertiary education in the past few years.
This administration is not losing sight of the tertiary institution. For a very long time, bursary has not been paid.
True.
This administration, we have paid bursary to our students in higher institutions all over Nigeria. And for the first time, we even used a very, very scientific approach. What did we do? We actually sent letters to all the higher institutions' heads, asking them to give us the data of the state in their school with the matriculation number and JAMB registration number. The money now goes to who the money should get to. We restored life back to Mapoli. Mapoli was actually comatose when this administration came on board. We actually need to solve that problem. The Tertiary College of Education, now secure editor of the College of Education, College of Education Science and Technology. That one was also having problems. This administration restored it. The curricula at that institution, the Tertiary College of Education, was expanded and the name changed. This administration did that. We added more courses, and then we have changed the name to rebrand the school. Even Tertiary University of Education, as we speak today now, you see that that institution has been able to take in more programs. Before, used to have purely courses that are BSc education. Now they even take courses that are BSc honors. And apart from that, we are able to run courses from first degree to PhD level now in Tasso. Mapoli, that was resuscitated We have added new programs to them. We have also given Mapoli the opportunity to run degree programs in affiliation with the Revitalization of Banjo University. Now, and apart from that, we are expanding the curricula of the various institutions. Sharpade, the one at Sharpade, the one at Tori, the one at Ibesa, and the one at Yemubo, the four ICT polytechnics, and also the health the tech. You see that we rebranded that school from Ogun State College of Health Technology. It became Ogun State Polytechnic of Health and Allied Sciences. So, with that, the curricula is also being expanded. They will be able to take in more programs that were not there before, and then the status of that institution is also being improved.
Expectedly, the efforts of the administration has begun to yield positive results, as students and pupils of the state have in the last 4 years won various laurels for the state. The Junior Engineers, Technicians and Science competition is only one of many such competitions where students have made the state proud. Teachers have also won awards of excellence, indicative of the nature of the environment created by the Ogun State government in order for excellence to thrive.